So let me thank you first for going out in the rain and braving it to get here. I think that more people are going to be dribbling in. People are not used to this in California, but we do have rain. It's awesome. So I want to introduce Pam Ronald, who is our speaker today. And I've known Pam for a while, and I'm really delighted you could be here. Pam is a professor at UC Davis. She's been there for 25 years. This is her 25th anniversary celebration today, actually. She's a professor of plant pathology. She is also one of the core faculty members in the UC Davis Genome Center. And she's a director of the grass genetics in the Joint Bioenergy Innovation Institute in Emeryville. So she's got a lot of hats. It's amazing we could actually get her down here even for a visit. I think one of the more interesting things that Pam has done, and which relates to our talk today, is that she's the founding faculty member of the Institute for Food and Agricultural Literacy at UC Davis. And when it comes to topics like genetics, GMOs, genetic engineering, the lack of literacy in the agricultural field, I think, creates all sorts of confusion. And so to have Pam be here today to talk about genetics, to talk about agriculture, and the role of different genetic technologies, I think is an incredible honor for us to be able to have such an informed speaker talk on this subject. Just a little bit of background. Pam did her BA in biology at Reed in Oregon, and then she learned most of what she knows about biology in her MA biology program here at Stanford. So that year was a critical year for her. Then went on to do a Fulbright scholarship over in Uppsala in Sweden, and did her PhD at UC Berkeley. And as I said, she's been at UC Davis for 25 years. Did, a really important postdoc at Cornell, though, where she started to explore genetics of different crops. Quickly moved towards rice, and rice is really her hallmark crop, and I think she'll talk about it quite a bit today. Obviously, the staple of billions of people around the world. And so a lot of the work that her lab does actually works on both stress tolerance and disease resistance in rice, and she's won a number of awards related to this. So if you look at what Pam's really delves into on a day-to-day basis, cell and developmental biology, molecular biology, biochemistry, genomics, and so forth, but she's going to translate a bit of this for a general audience today. But she writes incredibly well. She has many professional articles, countless actually, in Science, Nature, other leading genomics journals. But she also writes broadly for the lay audience. And so I just started making, you know, some notes from NPR, New York Times, Forbes, Wall Street Journal, CNN, Discover Magazine, popular scientists, and so forth. And so she is really has a very wide audience on this topic. I brought the book, which I love, this book, Tomorrow's Table, which she wrote with her husband, who runs the organic farm at UC Davis. And it's about organic farming, genetics, and the future of food. And I think they call it the botanical love story or something that brought them together on organics and GMOs. And it's a really good book, and it really lays out the facts. Some of you might have heard her TED Talk. In her 2015 TED Talk has had and this was on plant genetics, food security, and sustainable agriculture. It's had more than 1 million viewers. It's been translated into 17 languages. And so whatever language you want to use, we're really eager to hear you today. And I will end my introduction. David LaBelle, the Deputy Director of the Center on Food Security and the Environment, will do the moderation, and we look forward to the afternoon. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Roz, for a very nice introduction, and I'll do you all a favor and speak in English today. And thanks, Michelle, too, for the arrangements. So today I wanted to provide a brief overview of new technologies in plant genetics that are changing how we think about plant breeding. So first, some history. So for 10,000 years, we've altered the genetic makeup of our crops using different types of techniques. And today, virtually everything we eat has been genetically altered in one way or another. So initially, farmers carried out this primitive domestication. So they would simply select food plants with desired characteristics, collect the seed, and replant them. And that results in accumulation of characteristics over time. And we know from archaeological records that the ancient ancestors of wheat, rice, and corn were developed, starting to be domesticated more than 10,000 years ago. And the domestication was carried out in Turkey for wheat, and in China for rice, and in Mexico for corn. So this primitive domestication approach was rather crude, and over the centuries, it's been refined. And so I have sort of a list of more modern methods, beginning with grafting, which is putting two different species together. Forced pollination with the first intergeneric cross in 1876. So then again, you're mixing two genes from two very different species. We've had some radical approaches, such as mutation breeding, where you take the seed and you irradiate it, and then farmers will plant out the progeny and just pick those that have new characteristics that are of interest, and mutation breeding creates random mutations across the genome. Now, Gregor Mendel's experiments were, of course, very important, and he led to laws of inheritance. And this also really launched the science of genetics, and also had a huge impact on plant sciences, as you can imagine. And then in the 1900s, the first commercial hybrid companies were launched, which led to the development of very large seed companies. Many of you are familiar with those companies that still exist today. Now, the process of genetic engineering started where? Ooh, you have to know the answer to that. Here. So the first recombinant DNA molecules were established in a combination of scientists at Stanford and UCSF. And it was a very exciting time. The National Institute of Health set down rules for recombinant techniques because it was brand new. It's also similar to CRISPR. I would say in my lifetime, it's kind of the same sort of, oh my goodness, this is new, this is exciting, we better be careful. And so that was in 1973, and then the first company launched was Genentech, and the first product of genetic engineering was human insulin, which has been very important for the health of many diabetics. And now we have most of the cheeses we eat have been use an enzyme that was developed through genetic engineering. And then, of course, we have genetically engineered crops, with the first plant was genetically engineered in 1993. And it's been over 20 years since these crops were planted across the world. So what about the next 10 years? And the next 10 years will continue to include many, if not most, of these techniques, because they all have sort of their niches. But there are many new technologies, such as CRISPR, which we'll have a chance to talk about. So before I launch into discussion of new technologies, I want to just briefly describe hybridization. And the reason is that this was a very important part of plant breeding over the centuries, and also something we still use today, and it'll come up in our discussion likely. So in hybridization, you're basically mixing genes from two genetically distinct individuals. So you take pollen from one plant, the tassel of one plant, and you put it on the ears of another plant, and the seed that's harvested carries genes from both parents, and that's a hybrid. And the reason there's been so much excitement about hybrids is that it was discovered in 1879 that the hybrid plant has hybrid vigor, so it's much higher yielding, and this has been shown in many different types of crop plants. So these thousands of years of corn breeding have resulted in crops that are radically different than their ancestors. So this is the ancient ancestor of modern corn, which is teosinte, and it has very tiny seeds, grains that are covered in a hard case that you have to break open with a hammer.
And then we have modern corn, hybrid corn, which is about 100, produces about 100-fold more grain on a unit of land. So if humans still depended on this wild relative, we would need hundreds, if not thousands, of times more plants and acres to replace corn. So this is just to remind you one reason we genetically alter food crops. And to remember, the seed contains traits for yield, as I mentioned, taste, beauty, and nutrition. So that's one reason. And then, of course, we also alter crops because the seed that the farmer plants has a huge impact on the productivity of the land. So the farmers are looking for seed that is tolerant to environmental stress and resistance to disease and pests. So it's estimated that globally about 30 to 60% of potential yield is lost to pest, diseases, and environmental stress. So if we could simply create crops that have this resistance, well, we wouldn't have a food problem anymore. It's reducing waste. Okay, so what is sustainable agriculture? And there are three pillars: the social, economic, and environmental impacts. So when we're thinking about plant breeding or agriculture, we really must be sure that the poor have access to food they need to thrive. We must ask if farmers and rural communities can thrive and be sure everyone can afford the food, and we must minimize environmental degradation. So I want to just lay it out there right now that I believe that all appropriate technologies that will contribute to sustainable agriculture should certainly be considered when we're thinking about the future of our food systems. And I believe that often discussions about genes in our food become a distraction to really the greater goals of sustainable agriculture. And we can talk about that in the discussion. So now I want to describe a number of modern approaches that scientists are using for crop improvement and provide you just a few examples. So first, let's start with genetic engineering. So this was not the first method of genetic improvement, as you could see from that timeline, but I think it's fair to say that it was the first that received such a huge amount of public attention. So genetic engineering allows scientists to take a gene from any species and then put it into a plant. So you can move a gene from a virus into a plant. So why would a scientist want to do that? Sometimes it's the safest, cheapest, and most effective technology to advance sustainable agriculture and enhance food security. And I'll show you a couple examples. So this is papaya. How many of you heard of the papaya ring spot story? So about half of you. And I would say even 5 years ago, very few people had heard of it, but I think it's a lot of people are learning about it. So anyway, this is papaya. It's infected with papaya ring spot virus. And so plants get viral infections, as do people. And in the 1950s, this virus wiped out nearly all the papaya production on the island of Oahu. So it soon spread to other islands, and many scientists and farmers thought that Hawaiian papaya was doomed. But then a local Hawaiian, a plant pathologist named Dennis Gonzalez, decided to try to fight this disease using genetic engineering, which was very new at that time. So with government funding, he spliced a small snippet of DNA from the virus into the papaya genome. And this is one of his early field trials. So the green genetically engineered papaya is in the center, and they're immune to infection. And on the outside are the conventional papaya. And you can see that the drastic change in yields, about a 20-fold increase in yield with the genetically engineered papaya. And his work really led to rescuing of the papaya industry. So today, even 20 years later, there's still no other technology that can control this disease. So there's nothing you can spray. There's no organic technology. And so today, about 85% of papaya, Hawaiian papaya, is genetically engineered. And the papaya you buy in the store here is from Hawaii. So you've been eating genetically engineered papaya for about 20 years or so. So if you feel queasy about eating a gene from a virus, you need to consider that if you bite into an organic or conventional papaya that's infected with the virus, you're chewing on 10-fold more viral protein. And if you go into the store and you buy an organic papaya, you'll see actually the ring spots. So that's because it's infected with the virus. So now take a look at this caterpillar feasting on an eggplant. The black you see is frass. That's what comes out the back end of the insect. And in Bangladesh, this pest can destroy the entire crop if it's not controlled. So for this reason, farmers often spray insecticide 2 to 3 times a week, and sometimes even twice a day when the pest is very serious. But we know some insecticides are harmful to human health, and especially when farmers don't have proper protection like these children. So according to the World Health Organization, 300,000 people die every year in less developed countries because of exposure and misuse of insecticides. So to reduce chemical sprays on eggplant, Cornell and Bangladeshi scientists decided to try to use a genetic approach that builds on an organic farming technique. So organic farmers spray an insecticide called BT, and it's in this formulation called Dipel. And it's highly specific to caterpillar pests, but it's non-toxic to birds, fish, and humans. It's less toxic than table salt. But this strategy doesn't work well for eggplant farmers in Bangladesh because the sprays are very expensive, they're hard to find, and the insecticide doesn't prevent the insect from getting inside the plant. So with genetic engineering, scientists cut the DNA from the bacterial genome, and they put it directly into the eggplant genome. So will this approach work in Bangladesh? And the answer is yes. There's been several years in field trials now, and farmers in Bangladesh have cut down their use of insecticide sprays dramatically, often down to zero. Okay, so I want to move on to other types of techniques, because genetic engineering really is just one technique in the toolbox. And when we're trying to achieve sustainable agriculture, you don't want to get bogged down just sequencing and gene discovery has really exploded 15 years. So the Arabidopsis genome, so Arabidopsis is a little model plant, and it grows well in a petri dish, so a lot of plant geneticists like to work with it. It's like the fruit fly of plant genetics. So it was the first plant genome that was sequenced, and it took about 7 years. It cost $70 million and 500 people. Now, that same project today is expected, or, well, 2017, be 2 minutes and $99. So that's how fast technology is changing. And it's not only this little weed that we have sequenced for. We have sequenced for many other crop species, including wheat, whose genome is 125 times the size of Arabidopsis. The guide RNA binds to that specific region. And then there's another molecule called Cas9 that that is also then expressed in plants that will cut at that region to generate a break. That double-stranded break, if it's left untreated, then it leads to the death of the cell. So what every organism does, including humans, is there's an endogenous cellular mechanism that repairs that break. But that repair is imprecise. So sometimes mutations occur during the DNA repair. So essentially what scientists are doing is they're taking advantage of this error repair mechanism in organisms to introduce mutations in any gene of interest. So after the mutations, the guide RNA and the Cas9 protein can be removed through genetic analysis. So essentially, you can end up with just this small little break. And because there's no foreign genes, it's different than genetic engineering. So with genetic engineering, remember I said you're leaving the bacterial viral genes in the plant. For in this particular applications, you're not. You just have very small mutations. So this is a major difference with genetic engineering, but also limitations. So you can't, at this point in time, use this technique to develop papaya's resistance to virus infection or eggplant's resistance to insect infestation. But it has been used. So one of the first products is a mushroom, and this has been approved by the USDA. No special regulations, so just put that on the market as another type of product, and it was modified to resist browning, so essentially just deleted the enzyme that causes browning. And another example, researchers identified genetic variants that are associated with hornlessness in cattle. So this trait is common in beef, but dairy cattle all have small horns, and farmers routinely dehorn the cattle to protect their handlers and preventing the animals from hurting each other. And I thought, okay, well, I'm a plant biologist, I better watch this short video to understand how that's done. And it's really awful how they take the horns out. So the process is painful and frightening for the animals. And if you watch any of these videos, you wouldn't want your baby calf to have to go through that. So veterinary experts really were calling for alternatives. So scientists used genome editing and reproductive cloning to produce dairy cows that carry a naturally occurring mutation for hornlessness. So this approach has the potential to improve welfare of millions of cattle every year. And right now, the two bulls have been transferred to UC Davis, and they're carrying out breeding. So we'll be able to watch that soon. Okay, so there's such a huge amount of interest in CRISPR technologies. It's really remarkable. There's something like 8 scientific papers a day right now about CRISPR technology. And there are many different permutations that I didn't talk about, but I just wanted to give you the general idea. But I thought it would be interesting to show you that we even have there's like 3 or 4 papers about the crystal structure of the whole complex. So scientists actually know. So the white is that cutting enzyme called Cas9. And you could see in yellow is the target DNA, and then the guide RNA is red. So you can use scientific approaches to capture the whole complex and image it, which is helping scientists understand how it actually functions. So we are, now we can make edits in the genome. But this is a concept that I really like from Jake Korb of the Innovation Institute at UC Berkeley, is that we're really good at reading. We've been reading for a very long time, like this old woman. I think it's Rembrandt's mother. But we're really like children when it comes to writing genomes and editing genomes. So there really is a lot that we need to learn. There's a lot of limitations in the biology. And as some of us were talking about at lunch, it actually is pretty easy to create small mutations. But to get those into the plants or the animals and regenerate the entire plant or animal can be quite cumbersome. So there's still a lot of biology that we need to learn. So I wanted to just mention other types of approaches that geneticists are using. So there's a lot of high throughput phenotyping going on. And this has to do more with large scale imaging. So this is actually inside in a chamber, and these are little Rhabdopsis plants, but you can create, look at natural variants, or you can create induced mutations, or you can create genome edited plants, and you can run them through a lot of different conditions. Maybe you want to drought stress them. Then you can pick out those genetic variants that have a property that you're interested in, or you can infect them with a pathogen and pick out that genetic variant that has some sort of tolerance. And so I put this little video here. So this is a tobacco plant infected with a very serious disease, and it's a 4-day time lapse. So just to remind you that plants get sick, and that's one reason scientists are spending a lot of time on these approaches. So scientists now can screen for thousands and thousands of genetic variants, either in these chambers or even out in the field, as again we were talking about at lunch. So very large field experiments with cameras and you can use different types of conditions and identify those genetic variants that respond in an interesting way, and then use those for further breeding. So another method is computational predictive approaches. So scientists are generating massive amounts of data. Like just, there's no limits really now on the amount of data that we can generate. But to make sense of this data, we really need computational biologists. So I'm a geneticist, so I needed to partner with a computational biologist to take advantage of his statistical models to really predict the function of genes. So the idea is to identify genes and networks that underlie a particular plant trait. So this is work from in collaboration with Edward Marcotte's lab at the University of Texas. And what it is it's a network of 26,000 rice genes. So they're able to take a huge amount of data, 50 million data points for five species, and predict what types of genes will function in the same network. So if you see a red cluster, that's a cluster of genes that are highly predicted to function together in the same biological pathway. And the reason that's interesting is because we don't know what most genes in the plants do. We might know what one of these genes do, and if we can get connectivity with other genes, that gives us an idea what these other genes do. And so this is one application where my lab had knew what these genes in red, what their functions were. They're involved in stress tolerance. So we can query this network, and we can identify a cluster of genes and proteins shown in green that are predicted to function in the same pathway. And then we carry out genetic engineering approaches to validate function of those genes. So we were able to identify through that approach and some other types of proteomic approaches a gene that's involved in drought stress. So on the left are controls, and on the right are the plants genetically engineered with a novel gene that we identified through some of these integrated networks. And what we did is we withheld water for 8 days and then let the plant recover. So the plants are remarkably tolerant of drought stress, and we're actually now working on trying to understand this mechanism and also to put these plants into the field for field trials, because often you'll see something in the lab that doesn't translate to the field. So seed is just one component of a healthy farming system, and this is my husband's farm at UC Davis. And he plants a diversity of crops. It's one of the many ecological farming approaches he uses to keep his farm healthy. So I just want to remind you, so I'm a geneticist. I talk a lot about genetics, but it doesn't mean that we're not aware that farming practices need to go hand in hand. So farmers need genetically improved crops, and they are the ones that really are monitoring the healthiness of their farm. And you can do an internship at UC Davis and work in this very farm this summer if you want, if you can stand the heat. Okay, so I wanted to mention another area that I'm just going to touch on, but the plant microbiome. So almost all higher organisms, including plants and humans, are colonized by very complex microbial communities. And it's a really exciting time because emerging studies are showing that these microbiomes are structured to form a very complex interconnected microbial network. So this image shows a tomato plant. You have a plant pathogen that's infecting the stomata in the leaf, and that is causing the roots to exude particular compounds, which then attracts another type of microbe. And there is a whole really unknown set of communities that people are very, very excited about. But our understanding of microbial function and the molecules produced by these microbes is really lagging behind our ability to just identify the microbes. So right now, it's pretty easy to do what's called metagenomic sequencing, and you can identify what organisms are there, but then what do they do and how do they function together? And one of the long-term goals is to recreate complex communities and use them as soil amendments so that you can really enhance the productivity of a farm. So we've been in collaboration with Jose Danini here at the Carnegie Institute. We have been very interested in a microbial peptide. So it's produced by a microbe, and we discovered that it has a very strong effect on root growth. And Jose's labs use live root imaging, and you can see when we treat the root with water on the left, it grows kind of slow, but we treat it with just a small peptide from a microbe on the right, and we see this rapid root growth. So we're trying to understand what's going on here, but we do know in general that stimulation of root growth by microbes can possibly enhance yield or drought tolerance. And so one of the goals of microbiome research is to create these kinds of synthetic communities that will enhance drought tolerance or growth of the plant. Okay, so enhancing sustainable agriculture may seem like a very modest and agreeable goal. Yet for more than 100 years, There have been many worthy people have objected to this kind of research, and here is a quote by Maxwell Maxter, 1899, who's a British taxonomist. Many worthy people objected to the production of hybrids on the ground that it was an impious interference with the laws of nature. And it's almost exactly what many geneticists and breeders hear today. So public engagement is increasingly important, so it brings us to the last part of our talk here. So part of the job of a scientist is to communicate to others. And some of my family and friends worry, and they ask me, you know, how do you know foods with new genes are safe to eat? So genetic engineering has been used, as I mentioned, in many organisms for about 40 years. And to date, there hasn't been a single instance of harm to human health or the environment. But it really almost comes to a belief system. So I don't want my friends to believe me, because my opinion doesn't matter. Science isn't a belief system. We really need to look at the evidence. So after 20 years of careful study and rigorous peer review by thousands of independent scientists, every major scientific organization in the world has concluded that the genetically engineered crops that are currently on the market are safe to eat, and that the process itself of genetic engineering is no more risky than conventional methods of genetic alterations. And I suspect we're also going to conclude that no more risky than genome editing. So scientists, you know, we're like, oh, okay, I see, you know, AAAS, National Academy of Science, World Health Organization. Well, that sounds pretty good. I feel pretty good about that. But the public sees just a bunch of acronyms. And they also see this, very colorful, very exciting, very persuasive, and all over the internet. I think it really took an election over the Oval Office and the presidential campaign for many Americans to wake up to this concept of fake news. And I think those of us that work on climate change or vaccinations or plant genetics have been very aware of this. So it's really a challenge. Communicating is really a challenge. But why do we do this? And there's a great article by Atul Gawande in The New Yorker, and he says, having a scientific understanding of the world is fundamentally about how you judge which information to trust. So the National Academy of Sciences and Nature Magazine both had articles just in the last couple months about how scientists and academics have really an important role to play in science communication. And really the belief is that if we can take action, each of us, to engage with people beyond our peers, that we can have a positive impact. And so we at UC Davis, we have established the UC Davis Institute for Food and Agricultural Literacy. And our mission is really to not only communicate what we do, but to cultivate a community of researchers that can help demystify the process of science and provide science-based information on food and agriculture to consumers and policymakers and really anybody that wants to learn about ag. So the students have created a group called Science Really Says, and they address different questions that come up. We have a farmer's market program, and the students have an Ask a Scientist table, so anybody can bring their kids or come up and just ask any type of question. There was a campaign to get Barbara McClintock on the $10 bill, so I first learned about her when I worked in Ginny Walbert's lab, very famous corn geneticist. And we've been doing farm-to-table academies, so to bring in the community to learn about science and farming, and we bring in farmers to communicate with the public as well, and creating short 2-minute videos. It's a really powerful way to communicate the kinds of things that scientists do. Some of us have participated in this food evolution movie, so we're really excited that some very well-known documentary filmmakers are very interested in starting to communicate science. And you can see it says, show me the data. And this just premiered in New York City, and it will be available soon. There's a group at UC San Francisco led by Ron Vail that has been creating the program iBiology, and they've been releasing videos over the internet on different aspects of biology. And they recently started an initiative with Emmy Award-winning director Elliot Kirshner and the famous news broadcaster Dan Rather to communicate science to the general public. And I think this is going to be, again, another really important area where journalists and scientists can work together on very important topics. So we have a huge challenge in front of us. Let's celebrate science and use it to enhance food security and safeguard the environment. So thank you.